I would like to welcome our next speaker, Linda Rupert, who is an associate professor of history at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, and who is also president of the Forum on European Expansion and Global Interaction. So she's been researching on one of the most important subjects of Caribbean slave societies, namely runaway, the concept of running away from horrible slavery. And this is going to be a presentation that situates the Danish West Indies in a greater Caribbean context, which is, I think, going to be extremely interesting. So, welcome.
Thank you very much. And of course, I first want to start by thanking the many organizers, hosts, and sponsors of this event, both here and in our previous iteration in the Virgin Islands, as well as thanking my fellow presenters. It's really been an extraordinary experience. And I think all of us who've participated in this have been to many, many conferences. But the way this has been organized and the opportunities for interactions and discussions has really been unusual. And I think we're all very, very thankful for that. And there's also, of course, a huge amount of time and energy that goes into organizing this, which we're all very grateful for. I'm going to build on Josh's presentation in several ways. One, I'm going to talk a lot about the ties between the so-called Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. And one of the takeaways you got from Josh that you'll continue to get from my presentation is how arbitrary these political distinctions are, right? We talk about Puerto Rico, we talk about the Virgin Islands. These are very much European imperial constructs. And in fact, you see that in terms of geography, both physical geography and human geography, there are very close ties between these areas. Josh also mentioned in the Q&A something that both he and I could talk about at length, and neither of us will, which is the importance of these dugout canoes as transportation between the islands around the Caribbean. The runaway slaves I'm going to be talking about often used dugout canoes that were, in fact, based on the indigenous technologies. And this is a fundamental part of this that neither of us has central in our presentations, but we could certainly talk about at length. Finally, I want to say that my talk today is based in no small part on the incredible research that has been done and continues to be done by historians in the West Indies, in the Virgin Islands, and around the West Indies. I really could not do my work without the work that is being done and has been done in the islands. And I draw very much from the work of people who know these realities much greater than I do. What I'm going to do today is give you a somewhat of a wider perspective on slave flight from the so-called Danish islands to freedom in Spanish America. I work on runaway slaves, but I work on runaway slaves who crossed political boundaries in search of freedom. And this is based on a book I am currently writing and completing about the so-called Spanish sanctuary policy. There was a moment, I'll talk about it more in a minute, there was a moment in the 18th century when the Spanish actually offered freedom to slaves who arrived from the colonies of their rivals. And it's a very interesting moment politically and culturally and socially. And that's the book that I've been completing thanks to this fellowship at the John Carter Brown Library this year. And actually, technically this week, I'm still a fellow at the John Carter Brown Library, but they've generously allowed me to spend the last week of my fellowship here at this extraordinary conference. So there was a series of royal decrees that the Spanish crown issued for about 100 years, beginning in the late 17th century, which offered freedom to runaway slaves who arrived in Spanish colonies from the colonies of other European powers. This included Danish, Dutch, French, and British colonies around the Caribbean and beyond. Now, as I talk about this, I want you to think about this as a story of refugee migrants. All right, and this is a map from the New York Times from a couple of years ago that shows the current migration flows of refugees. And I want to suggest to you as I go through my presentation today that there are many similarities between these runaway slaves and refugees and asylum seekers throughout human history. All too often we tend to marginalize, we tend to segregate slavery and enslaved people as something very distinct and different from the rest of human history, when in fact more and more historians are recognizing that the themes, the topics, the approaches are really similar to any other group of human beings. And this is certainly the case with runaway runaway slaves. So my principal argument in my book is that fugitive slaves who crossed imperial lines in the early modern Caribbean were in fact refugees and asylum seekers. And like refugees and asylum seekers throughout human history, their fate depended on a confluence of various factors. Their own resourcefulness. Some people migrate, others stay home throughout history. So it takes a certain kind of initiative and resourcefulness to migrate. The local reception when they arrived in the places they migrated to. And again, this is a universal characteristic. And finally, the wider geopolitics around their migrations. All right, now this was a small minority of slaves. The vast majority of people who were enslaved stayed on plantations, did not have the opportunities to migrate. So we're talking about a very small subset. But I think their experiences teach us a lot and are very worth studying. So I want to set the stage for you, because this so-called Spanish sanctuary policy actually has its roots in the island of St. Croix in the 1660s. All right, in mid-1664, we have documentary references to a group of people, four people, three men and a woman, who paddled a small dugout canoe, a piragua, from St. Croix to nearby Puerto Rico. All right, and at the time, St. Croix was under French control. And here's Puerto Rico. Okay. They were gently propelled westward by favorable winds and currents, and their short journey was likely not terribly arduous, even in such a simple sea craft. Unless they were traveling under cover of complete darkness, they would have remained within sight of at least one of the islands or several of the uninhabited keys at all times. Now, some of these are photographs from my own reconnaissance that I've done around the region. As they approached Puerto Rico, they would have been guided by the looming peak of El Yunque, the tallest peak in the eastern part of Puerto Rico, rising 3,500 feet out of the tropical rainforest. Perhaps they took temporary refuge on one of the many uninhabited keys that lie just offshore from eastern Puerto Rico, which you can see here. Here are some of them. Their landing likely was not without major incident, as there are many long sandy shores along the eastern coast of Puerto Rico, interspersed with sheltered coves, all of which would offer relatively easy landing. And this area, not coincidentally, was one also a vigorous so-called contraband trade, that is, unauthorized trade across political boundaries. Now, these four travelers might very well have disappeared into the jungle and into historical oblivion to quietly begin new lives of freedom. But they were captured and jailed, and because of that, we have a historical record. Colonial officials disagreed about their fate. Some argued that these slaves should be auctioned to local landowners, who were short of enslaved labor, with the profits going to the royal coffers. The governor of Puerto Rico, Juan Pérez de Guzmán, thought that they should be freed. And he appealed to the Council of the Indies, which advised the Spanish crown in all matters related to the Spanish colonies. And the quote that we have from him in the historical record is, "It does not seem appropriate that the king reduce to slavery people who seek his protection," the governor wrote to the crown. The crown agreed and declared that these slaves should be free. And this is the first documented record I've been able to find, or any other historian has been able to find, of the Spanish crown granting freedom to refugees who came from colonies of other powers. And so we have these four migrants unwittingly being apparently the instigators of what would eventually become what historians have come to call the Spanish sanctuary policy. So I'm going to give you a brief overview of that policy. This is a multicolored map of the Caribbean from a slightly later period, from the second half of the 18th century, and the different colors show you the different imperial spheres that claimed parts of the Caribbean. And my argument is that this so-called Spanish sanctuary policy was not envisioned from above by a distant king and council or neatly put into place across the Atlantic. Instead, it developed piecemeal over more than a century. In some of the most sparsely populated and marginal parts of the Spanish Empire. and it was in direct response to the migrations of hundreds of enslaved individuals who crossed Caribbean waters in search of freedom, and the confusion and disagreement their arrival caused among colonial officials. And the particular physical and human geographies of the Caribbean helped shape the contours of this policy. And so here you can see the pink is areas that were claimed by the Spanish. The pink is areas that were claimed by the British. This is a later period in the map. The green is areas that were claimed by the Spanish. The yellow is areas that were claimed by the French, etc. So this is the first official royal decree we have been able to locate regarding to this policy, and it was actually issued for Trinidad in May 1680. Okay, 16 years after the migration of these Crucian slaves. And it offered freedom to all those blacks who came in search of faith from any of the foreign countries which occupy territories in this kingdom shall enjoy freedom. And this decree, like most of the others, was spurred by the arrival of a group of runaway slaves from the English-owned islands to the north of Trinidad. And as the wording here makes abundantly clear, this decree was not so much about offering protection to vulnerable people as it was about exerting Spain's ongoing claims to relatively marginal groups, relatively marginal areas that were being threatened by the presence of other European powers. Like Puerto Rico, Trinidad was thinly populated, and Spanish control was tenuous at best, and it was repeatedly attacked by ships flying other European flags. So that's Trinidad 1680. Then, 7 years later, in October 1687, six men and a woman, and two women, one who was carrying a baby, paddled a small canoe from British South Carolina to St. Augustine, Florida. Now, at this time, the previous map I showed you, Florida was then under British control. But in this earlier period, pink is the British territory, green is claimed by France, and yellow is under Spanish control. And so they paddled from the British colonies to the north to the Spanish outpost of St. Augustine in Florida. And Governor of Quiroga of Florida wrote when they were captured. Again, if they hadn't been captured, we wouldn't know about them. But they were captured, and Governor Quiroga of Florida wrote to the Spanish crown asking, "Your Majesty, tell me what I should do with them." So again, we have this issue of conflict and not knowing how to handle these refugees. And there was extensive transatlantic correspondence between the Spanish colonial and royal officials as small groups of people continued to arrive by land and by sea from the British colonies to the north. Finally, in 1693, 5 years after the first group of people arrived, the Spanish crown issued another royal decree, freeing eight men and two women who had arrived the year before, as well as all the other foreign fugitives who already were there and any who might arrive subsequently. So now we have the second official royal decree and the third place where this is happening around the Caribbean, and we see the beginning of what will become a policy, but it's very ad hoc and it's very piecemeal and tentative. Okay. So eventually, and this is a an archival depiction of St. Augustine. Eventually, the crown gave all these refugees land, grouped them into their own town, Gracia Real de Santa Teresa de Mose in Florida, and it's now a site that is administered, I believe, by the National Park Service, and you can go there and see the plaque. And this is the area in just north of St. Augustine where it's located. Now no longer, there are no traces of the actual town anymore, but this is where archaeologists have determined that it was located. And the crown also conscripted the men into a militia of free blacks. All right, and this would happen around the region as well, creating towns, giving people land, and creating militias of free blacks. And so it went with the consolidation of European empires in the 18th century, the consolidation of the plantation complex and the transatlantic slave trade throughout the Caribbean. Marronage, running away, became one of the most important forms of resistance to slavery. So many people stayed local, others sought freedom farther away, especially across Caribbean waters. Time and again, refugees who arrived in the Spanish colonies found their destinies embroiled in power struggles among local elites, who, when they couldn't agree, appealed to the crown. And so throughout the first half of the 18th century, the crown responded by offering freedom to those migrants who arrived in some of the more marginal parts of the Spanish Empire. And these are the major Spanish decrees that I have been able to locate in a variety of archives in Europe and throughout the Circum-Caribbean with their dates. And so you can see they're selected areas, and all of these are relatively marginal areas. Okay. Then at mid-century, in 1750 and 1753, the Spanish crown issued two much broader, what I call blanket decrees, that made the policy effective across Spanish America. Okay, in New Spain in 1750, and then in Peru and Nueva Granada in 1753. And from then until the crown rescinded the decrees in 1790, is the era that we know for about 40 years of this so-called Spanish sanctuary, where slaves who arrived from any colony that was under the possession of a rival power could find freedom anywhere in Spanish America. But as you can see, in order to get to 1750, we go through many intermediate stages. And you can also see that even after the blanket decrees, there are decrees issued for specific places. Right, that continued. And this is the basis of the book manuscript I'm completing. And now you're going to get what really can only be described as my proudest moment in terms of map making and sophisticated GIS. Oh, no, I'm sorry, not yet. Just wait. This is the Royal Decree of 24th of September, 1750. Henceforth and forever, all black slaves of both sexes who come from English and Dutch American colonies to seek refuge, whether during wartime or peacetime, in my dominions, to embrace our holy Catholic faith, shall be free. Upon arriving in my dominions, they are free, and under no circumstances should they be sold or returned to slavery. There's a lot to unpack there that we can certainly return to in the Q&A, but that in a nutshell is now what we have as the Spanish sanctuary policy. And it was widely known throughout the region. This version of it is actually from a court case in Venezuela that I found related to runaway slaves from the Dutch island of Curacao. Okay. Now, my proudest moment, my very high-tech GIS map. All right, I know, you know. And this shows you the basic contours of the areas from which people fled, from English, French, Dutch, and Danish islands, and the primary areas in Spanish America in red to which they fled. And again, the caveat always is, we only know about the people who made it into the historical record. Right? If people were captured, if their arrival caused some sort of a kerfuffle, then we know about it. If they didn't, then we don't know about it. All right, but this gives you sort of a general overview, and a lot of it has to do with winds and currents, as well as geopolitics, and as well as, not coincidentally, these are relatively marginal parts of the Spanish Empire to which people flee. Now, of course, enslaved people traveled elsewhere in search of freedom before, during, and after the Spanish sanctuary policy. But this offer of freedom provided a particular opportunity that migrants could take advantage of by crossing political boundaries. And I'm going to speak very briefly now about the situation in the islands that were under Danish control. Okay. Because the Spanish sanctuary policy had a major impact on enslaved people who lived on the Caribbean islands that were under Danish control. And there's a particularly rich archive of this. There's a lot of documentation for this that is very rich. Some people traveled directly to the eastern coast of Puerto Rico. Other people traveled along the northern coast. Here's San Juan, but this is the part of Puerto Rico where enslaved people from other imperial spheres would land primarily. And we have documented cases of hundreds of enslaved people who crossed into Puerto Rico, especially from St. Thomas and St. Croix, but also from English and French islands and some Danish and some Dutch examples farther to the east. By the mid-1720s, there were at least 90 maritime maroons from the Danish islands in Puerto Rico. As in Florida and elsewhere, the Spanish crown ordered them relocated into a new town, San Mateo de Cangrejos, just outside of San Juan, and it's present-day the neighborhood of Santurce, outside of San Juan. And the men were conscripted into a free black militia. And here is a depiction of a militiaman from Cangrejos. And here is a depiction of San Juan. And it's very difficult to find maps that actually locate Cangrejos. I found a few of them. But Cangrejos would have been right outside the town walls. And as I say, this crown also grouped the men into a free black militia. What better loyal subjects to the crown than slaves who'd been freed, right? And especially what better people to fight against Spain's rivals than people who had been slaves of Spain's rivals. And this was a tactic that the Spanish crown deployed throughout the region. Now, I want to talk very briefly about one very intriguing document that shows the geopolitics of this. And this is actually a document that I found in the John Carter Brown Library this year. It's part of a much wider case. It seems that the John Carter Brown Library has the only copy of this document. And it dates from 1735, just a couple of years after the Danes purchased St. Croix from the French. And this is a very interesting example of the geopolitics of it, because this is an anonymous report by one of the Spanish ministers about the fact that this island of St. Croix, the Spanish should continue to claim the island of St. Croix. They should not allow, they should not recognize Danish possession of the island. And it's a document that goes on, it's quite lengthy. But what's interesting is they base their argument on the arrival of 8 men and 2 women who had escaped slavery from St. Croix and arrived in Puerto Rico. And the argument is that St. Croix was always under Spanish possession, therefore the French never had legitimate claim to it, therefore the French could not sell it to the Danes, therefore these slaves were still in a Spanish possession, therefore they came to Puerto Rico, they're Spanish slaves, which is all very well and good, except the Spanish then free them. So it's a really bizarre kind of interesting document, but I haven't finished sorting it out. When I do, I'm going to publish something about it. But what's interesting is it clearly shows that these runaway slaves were embroiled in wider geopolitics, and that the various empires used them for sort of wider geopolitical arguments. And there are many other such documents around the region from different empires, but this is particularly interesting because it's about St. Croix. Now, we also have very rich documentation from a variety of sources about not only the extensive number of slaves from the Danish islands who were in Puerto Rico, but also the fact that they're very much tied to not only, this is the illicit movement of people, they're also tied to the illicit movement of goods. If you will, we can kind of think of these slaves as being part of a wider smuggling economy, but they're smuggling themselves. And so this is the observation of an English sailor, John George, who was in Puerto Rico in the late 1740s, so this is before the blanket Spanish decree of sanctuary, but already at a time when there are many slaves arriving in Puerto Rico. And he says, "This town is a nest of pirates and an asylum for runaway Negroes from our islands and the Danes and the Dutch. There was no less than 19 fine slaves arrived here from St. Croix in the time I left that place. And the last year, 42 of them ran away with a fine sloop and brought her in here from St. Croix, and others daily are coming here." And this also kind of gives you a sense of the kinds of sources we have for documenting this. Often just numbers, rarely names of people. Here, just an image of Christiansted, St. Croix, and just the point I want to make here is that the development of plantations in the second half of the 18th century led to even more extensive numbers of slaves on the islands, and hence more people who were interested in running away, while the development of ports for trade provided opportunities for people to run away, and especially the vigorous contraband trade. In the Danish and Dutch islands especially, but also in the French and English islands, enslaved men worked very extensively in the maritime economy. Some were sailors who traveled on the many vessels that traded around the region. Others hid away on sailing vessels, sometimes bribing the captains. And occasionally an entire group of people would commandeer a sailing vessel. We also have cases of fishermen. Okay, who deserted their fishing expeditions? Fishermen, enslaved fishermen who would go out and could just keep traveling. This is an excerpt from a runaway slave advertisement in the Royal Danish Gazette from 1773, where a mulatto man named Aaron, a fisherman by trade, had run away from his master, and his master warned that all persons who have fishing boats take care of them. Canoes. Various kinds of small dugout canoes and other kinds of vessels. Some people built rafts or stole canoes. Here's another advertisement from the Royal Danish American Gazette from the late 1770s, where nine men, and interestingly they're named, we very rarely have names of people, but here's an example of people who are named. Nine men who worked on the Jerusalem estate stole a certain canoe which lay on the bay contiguous to the estate. Now, not everyone was successful. And of course, the people who died en route, we might have a brief mention of them running away, but we don't know the details. But Oldendorp does mention a man who, quote, built a vessel in secret in which he wanted to escape from slavery, along with his family. His boat sank, however, because he had no pitch in which to caulk the hull. Only his son was able to save his own life by swimming ashore. So that's just a reminder that not everyone was successful. Now, this did not go unnoticed in diplomatic spheres, okay? And there were official complaints to Spain by all the ambassadors and governors. And there's extensive correspondence in the diplomatic archives. And here are just two examples of French and Dutch complaints about this. And these complaints eventually yielded results. And in fact, in 1767, Spain and Denmark signed a treaty for the mutual restitution of returned slaves. Now, this was the culmination of years of negotiation at multiple levels. In fact, as early as the 1710s, Danish slaveholders and merchants had been complaining to the Danish crown about this marronage from the Danish islands to Puerto Rico and asking that this be taken up in diplomatic circles. And it took the better part of half a century before that in fact happened. Now, eventually, the Spanish did rescind the royal decree. Temporarily, but they never reinstituted it. In May 1790, the royal decree declared the granting of freedom for slaves from foreign colonies who find refuge in our colonies will for now be suspended. Such news shall be communicated to slaves from foreign colonies, so their frequent migration will cease. All right, and then a couple of months later, because this information takes time to be transmitted, a couple of months later, here is, in fact, is an announcement in the Bahama Gazette in August of 1790. The asylum which has hitherto been afforded to runaway Negroes in the Spanish colonies on the pretense of religion has been lately abolished. Okay. So obviously this was of great interest to colonial officials and plantation owners in the Danish, Dutch, English, and French colonies, and of course, of most interest to the enslaved people who did not stop running away, but now no longer had the umbrella of the Spanish sanctuary. And of course, people did continue to escape. So these are some images, just to conclude here, these are some images from the past couple of years of contemporary refugee seekers and asylum seekers, okay? The top one in the left-hand corner is from the Mediterranean. These two are on the U.S. southern border. This is a really interesting SUV that has a ladder that comes down it. And then this is an image from people fleeing from Venezuela to Curaçao, which is kind of an interesting reverse migration because the Dutch island of Curaçao off the coast of Venezuela, enslaved people used to free to Venezuela, and now there's a whole out-migration the other direction. And I show you these images to conclude because, again, I just want to make the point that runaway slaves were not some sort of a marginal, secondary, insignificant aspect of the history of slavery. In fact, they were asylum seekers and refugees who created new lives for themselves, much as refugees and asylum seekers have throughout history. In the early modern Caribbean, a few intrepid individuals found the means, motives, and opportunity to flee the horrifying circumstances of the brutal plantation complex and its draconian slave codes, taking enormous risks to cross political and geographic boundaries in search of better lives. And so the lives of these seemingly marginal Afro-Danish fugitives several hundred years ago can resonate with us today and inform our understanding both of Caribbean history and also of world currents in the 21st century. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation. So, are there any questions? So, shall I go first?
You seem to do that.
I thought this is, of course, as a historian working with the history of the Danish period in the Virgin Islands, it's not unknown. Mm-hmm. We've always had this, you know, little, there was this story that when you fled, you could actually flee to Puerto Rico and maybe through Vieques and find your sanctuary there. So we know the dates and so on, but suddenly it was just put into this greater perspective mm-hmm. for me. So I think that was really fantastic. And then I'm thinking, so there is this religious argument that if you flee, you become a Catholic. And that's sort of the reason why they could pull it off. So, but what about the people from the French islands? Because obviously there is a thing that in all of the Protestant colonies, there wasn't really any large interest in mission work until late 18th century. So few people of African descent were actually Christians. And if they were, many of them were in some sort of Protestants, even though the Catholic history of the Virgin Islands is still untold, actually, in the 18th century. But what about the French Catholic colony?
Oh, it's so much more complicated than even that. So, so one of the intriguing things to try to sort out with these royal decrees is time and again they do mention religion. And to try to get a handle how important really was religion. And of course, this is a greater debate among historians of the Spanish Empire, right? To what is the relationship between crown and church, and with these royal decrees, to what extent is this a really fundamental part of the policy, and to what extent is it sort of more secondary? And you know, how is religion used as a political tool, right? It's not just the French. I first became involved in this because my first book was about Curaçao, and I encountered these enslaved Afro-Curaçaoans who would go to Venezuela. There are documented cases of over 1,000 seeking freedom, and you have documents from the Dutch West India Company. You have a list of over 600. And several hundred more cases that are outside of that list. And you have cases in the Venezuelan records of these court cases. And time and again, they talk about buscando las aguas sagradas del bautismo, you know, seeking the sacred waters of baptism, fleeing their heretical owners. There's just one problem. Yes, Curaçao was a Dutch colony under the rule of the Dutch West India Company. But to make a very long story short, by the early 18th century, essentially 100% of Afro-Curaçaoan slaves were baptized Catholic by the Roman Catholic Church. And yet you have the court records saying time and time again that these slaves are looking for baptism. right? So that's how I got into this larger project, as I started trying to find the article or the book about the Spanish sanctuary policy that would explain this to me, and it didn't exist. And so this book originally was going to be about Afro-Curaçaoan slaves in Venezuela, and now it's much larger. With the French islands, it is, again, very long story short, it's a bit more complicated because most of the decrees about the French are much more specific, and they have to do with the realities of Hispaniola and the slaves crossing the mountains between French Saint-Domingue and Spanish Santo Domingo. And most of those decrees are very specific. And the blanket decrees are primarily aimed at least nominally Protestant powers of the Danish, the Dutch, and the British. And in fact, those blanket decrees specifically mention the British and the Dutch. So very long, but could be have been a lot longer answer to a very complicated question. Yeah. Well, I know you and I had also talked about ethnicities and some of the challenges here. You know, the question of who migrates, right, and who flees. And I'm the granddaughter of immigrants, and so I know that it, in the case of my grandparents, you know, these were individuals who, for whatever reason, decided to go from Europe to the States, and they had many cousins and other family members, siblings, who did not. So the question of who migrates, when you talk about a slave economy, gets into ethnicities, gets into type of employment of the slaves. Were these largely plantation slaves or maritime slaves or house slaves? And these are very important questions that it's very difficult to answer except in very specific places, because we often don't have the information. You and I were talking about ethnicities. I think someone could begin to reconstruct for very specific places what role ethnicity had among the various African groups or generation. Were these mostly first generation? There's been some good work done on Hispaniola between French Saint-Domingue and Spanish Santo Domingo, showing that often it's first generation slaves who make that crossing. But can we extrapolate, and is this a wider trend? It's very difficult to know. So much of this, of course, is not unknown.
Thank you very much. When you make the comparison to what's going on today about migration or immigration to things, there's this difference than in those days, enslaved people were private property. Mm-hmm. And so today we think about the migration as a burden to countries they come to. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I would think that Puerto Rico would think that this is new labor. So this, in a way, from a Spanish perspective, an economic positive thing. So how do you think about this?
Oh, absolutely. I agree with you entirely. I think the reference to migrations today is limited in some ways, but there are times and places throughout human history. There's a huge literature on migrations, and obviously there are moments when migrants are welcomed, right? And for political, economic, social, cultural reasons, and there are moments when migrants are not welcomed. And that, you know, is very varied throughout human history. My primary reason for making the connection is, I think, to bring out the human element, because so often so much of the study of slavery has talked about people as commodities. And yes, that is absolutely important, right? And the point that many of these people arrived in marginal parts of the Spanish Empire, I don't think it's coincidental that these were the areas that the Spanish gave them freedom, right? This was a way of enticing labor. But there were also major disagreements, right? A lot of times when these migrants were captured on the coast, some of the most intriguing cases are about who has the right to own them and to own their labor, or to sell them. And if they're sold, who does a percentage of that sale have to go to the royal coffers, right? So there are all sorts of important issues here around the fact that these are people who are commodities. But at the same time, I just want to give a little nudge and remind you that the reasons that people migrate are, you know, somewhat universal. But your point is very well taken.
Any more questions? Yes.
I think it's time for the coffee break.
Yeah. One last question and then we'll have the coffee.
This is really short. I would just like you to reiterate what I at least understood. I'm not exactly sure if that's what you meant. I've really enjoyed listening to you talk about this because I didn't know very much about it beforehand. But you're also saying it's part of the land grabbing or holding on to land. The slaves are also a part of that colonial strategy, as far as I understand you. Right or not right?
Yeah, no, I think so. I think the document I showed from St. Croix, and there are other such documents for Trinidad, for Yucatan, for around the region. I think this not so much maybe land grabbing as imperial claims to territory, right? Which in the case of the Caribbean is very iffy for anyone of a number of reasons. But the Spanish lay claim to far more territory than they can actually effectively control. And so getting bodies to these places and establishing towns of free blacks and having people work the land is one way of establishing effective control over territory that they claim. So I do think that there's various geopolitical elements, to say nothing of just sticking it to their enemies, right? That's another important aspect of it, but yes.
Thank you.